BGMC. The biblical truth lives here.
The ancient Hebrew scriptures foretold of the Anointed One, Yeshua HaMashiach. The Messiah Yeshua came to call the people back to the truth of His word and to follow that righteous path. Yeshua then called Jewish men to be His disciples, and after His death and resurrection, those Jewish men told the world about the Jewish Messiah. Now, after 2,000 years, Beth Goyim Messianic Congregation has that same calling of those Jewish men, telling all people, both Jew and Gentile, about the proper ancient path, teaching the Route 66 King's Highway from Genesis through to Revelation, and how you need and can get back to the proper roots of the faith and a closer walk with God. Now, let's hear the message.
Let's go get a blessing. Let's go get a blessing. Turn to the book of Parash, Genesis chapter 28. Genesis chapter 28. This is message E276. E276. It is Parash number 7. Excuse me. Parash number 7. Okay? It goes from Genesis, Parash 28, verse 10, through chapter 32, verse 3. Now, also, if you are looking on our website, we have a new section on our website where you can go to messianicstudent.org. You'll see the discipleship television picture there with the blue guy on the left. But then you'll see a Torah scroll with a cross in the middle of it, and you'll see Messianic Torah Time. If you've missed any of these parashas, I've now designed a part of our website. I'm trying to get all the parashas there. We got them from 012, 013, that's in one section. And 013, 14, I'm working on 15, 16 now, so that you can, if you miss any of the parashas, see, the parashas, the Torah portion, is very important. You need to understand basics. You know, get really good with your basics and your Torah portion. Then when you go to read other stuff, it really does make a lot more sense. So we've made a section of our website there under messianicstudent.org. Click on the Messianic Torah Time logo with the Torah scroll, and then the cross in between it there. And then also what we started doing this week, we've tried a test run on Bible study night. We're now streaming on YouTube, so you can go to Bgmc, hit the space bar once, and then TV. Bgmc TV, Bgmc TV. All right, that's enough of the commercials. And let's go to Bereshit. Let's go to the main theme of this parash. Turn to Genesis, Bereshit 29, verse 8. 29, verse 8. Bereshit 29, verse 8. The main theme of this message is flocks. Flocks, okay? Flocks of sheep and flocks of people. They answered, "We can't, not until all the flocks have been gathered together." And they roll the stone away from the opening of the well, that's when we water the sheep. Amen? So Yaakov had come to, he finally came to Padan Aram, and he was meeting the people there, and he said, you know, why go pasture your flocks, you know, and you know, water them and pasture them. But they were waiting for some of the sheep to come in. Now, it's very important to understand that when the living water comes, it's when everything is said and done, when all the sheep are gathered together, okay? When all the sheep are gathered together, that is when the Son of the Promise, let me say that again, when all the sheep are gathered, that's when the Son of the Promise will roll away the stone so that all the sheep can have the living water, okay? So they were waiting, and we'll see more about that, but that's the main purpose of this. It's a gathering of the flocks, okay? The gathering of God's flocks, His sheep from different groups of people. He's gathering them in into one area so that He can water them with the living water. Mayim chayim, oh, drink freely. All right, let's go on to the next picture and the next slide. Let's turn back to one chapter, to Bereshit, Genesis chapter 28, verse 10 and 11. Bereshit chapter 28, Genesis chapter 28, verse 10 and 11. I'll give you a moment to get there. Okay, Bereshit chapter 28, verse 10 and 11. Yaakov went out from Beersheba and traveled toward Haran. He came to a certain place and stayed there the night. Stayed the night there and did it backwards. But the sun had set. He took a stone from the place, put it under his head, and lay down there to sleep. Now, I don't know about you, but I hate hard pillows. I really, you know, I got the gushiest pillow one could get. I like to be able to mush it under my head, get it right there under your neck, the crick of your neck, and then stay there for the next 6 hours or 5 hours, I generally get. But here, Yaakov had just left his home. He's, you know, last week we were going through the whole situation where the whole getting the birthright, but then not telling anybody that Esau sold the birthright, the mother doing the whole thing, putting the costume on her son. Now he's leaving. He's got to go over to stay with her brother. And, you know, here he is now. He's in the desert alone. In the desert alone. Let me say that again if you're taking notes. In the desert alone, and he's tired from his journey. There's nobody around. He just doesn't have like a cot that he can set up. And he puts his head on the rock. Puts his head on the rock. See, a lot of times when we're in the desert and we've done something wrong, okay, the Lord doesn't want to destroy you, but he wants you to realize what you've done wrong. Because remember, sin separates us from God. Let me say that again. Sin separates us from God. So here, he's on his journey, and he's got no bed to lay on. He's all alone. He hasn't made his destination. He's got to trust in God, and he puts his head on something ridiculously hard. I mean, I'd rather just lay flat on the ground and maybe just put my arm under my head than put my head. I mean, look at the picture there. You got the guy. I mean, you know, he's got his hand under his head, but, you know, that would, I mean, how long could you lay on a rock? I mean, rocks are not smooth. They got bumps. I mean, you got to be tired to even just consider it. But what is the picture that the Lord is drawing? That's more the case. There's always a reason for everything. And it says now, let's read it again. Chapter 28, verse 10, 11. Yaakov went out from Beersheba and traveled toward Haran. He came to a certain place and stayed the night there. Because the sun had set, he took a stone from the place and put it under his head to lay down there to sleep. Okay, so what do we draw from this sentence? What do we draw from these two sentences? Okay, he's in Beersheba. Okay, it's a place of a promise. Okay, he's traveling towards his destination, to the place that his family told him to go to. A certain place, he stayed there the night. We don't know the certain place, it just says a certain place. Okay, the sun had gone down. So now, you know, picture yourself in a place, you know, I know around where I live here, around New York City, it never gets dark. Okay, so let's say, you know, we don't know what season it is, okay, what time of the month it is, you know, whether it's new moon or fading moon, waxing, waning or waning moon. We don't know if it's near the middle of the month where the moon would be out. We don't know if it's cloudy. But just picture this. He's alone. He pulls up a rock, and it's dark. And you've just had this situation in your life where, you know, you had to be feeling a little remorse about tricking your father into giving you the blessing. Okay, anybody that's got any of God inside of him, any of the Lord's fear of the Lord, you got to know, that wasn't so good. So now you're alone. Okay, that's when the Lord does the most work. When we're in a place that's dark, a place that we're alone. So when you're in the desert alone, and you're in a place alone, that's when the Lord is trying to get our attention. So here Yaakov, even though he was the son of the promise, the Lord is going to speak with him. See, when you're in that dark place, put your head on the rock. Okay? It's specific here in the end of verse 11. It's really key to the word to understand each word. Now, that's what we teach here at Beth Goyim, is to look at the sentence, slow down your reading, and why does it say he put his head on the rock? You know, in the picture there, well, his head is sort of on the rock, but it's more of his shoulder. Okay, but no, the word is saying he put his rock under his head. Rock under his head. See, when you're in a place and you know you've done something wrong, and you're on a journey to the place that you need to be, put your head on the rock. Now, why put your head on the rock? Hold your place there in Bereshit 28. Turn to Matthew 7, Matthew 7, verse 25. Okay, we're going to key here on the word rock. Okay, why is he putting his head on the rock? Matthew 7, verse 25. Matthew 7, verse 25. Matthew 7, Matthew 7, verse 25. The rain fell, the rivers flooded, the winds blew, and beat against that house. But it didn't collapse because its foundation was on rock. Let me say that again. The rain fell, the rivers flooded, the winds blew, and beat against that house. But it didn't collapse because its foundation was on rock. Amen? So here, Yaakov had, you know, he had done something that wasn't correct. He was honoring his mother, but he was not honoring his father. In Parash number 6, what we went over about the whole trickery that he did. Even though he owned the birthright, he should have spoken up and allowed his father, his earthly father, to decide whether or not he wanted to give the blessing to him as a firstborn son. Even though Yehovah had said to the mother, listen, the older is going to serve the younger. Okay, so Yeshua is using that as a reference. See, when the rivers are flooding and the winds are blowing, as long as your head is on the rock, as long as your foundation, this is your foundation. Your feet are, you know, you always think of your feet as your foundation, but your brain has got to be on the foundation. Your brain has got to be on the foundation. As long as your foundation is the Word of God, Yeshua is the rock, as long as you got him in your head, and not just in your head, but following his commandments, fearing God and following his ways, then you will, no matter what the storm is, you will have strength. Even in the darkest place, you know, this is why Yeshua uses the parable. The rain falling, the rivers flooding, the winds are blowing. It's not going to be light and airy outside. You're not going to see the stars. You're not going to see the moon. If the rains are falling and the rivers flooding, that means there's a storm swirling around you. Okay, so here Yaakov had a storm swirling around him. He's all alone and he puts his head on the rock. So when you're in the storm, no matter what is going on, no matter what is going on, the Lord has a personal relationship with each and every person. If you put your head on the rock, if every morning you do the Shema Yisrael, Yehovah Eloheinu, Yehovah Echad, okay? As long as you do that, and you start your day off with the Word of God, you put your head on the rock, no matter what storm you are facing, you shall not fall. It is not by might, not by power, not by might, but by my Spirit, says Yehovah. Okay? When you put your head on the rock in the dark places, then the Lord will lift you up. Remember, Yosef was in the dungeon. He had done nothing wrong. You know, the dungeon was a stone, right? Was a stone? Okay? I'm sure they didn't have cots to sleep in. So we had to pull up a rock. But as long as you hold on to that rock, as long as you put your head on that rock and know that the Lord is the rock, that he is your foundation, then you will get through the darkness. Now turn to 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter, Kepha Aleph. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 6 through 9. 1 Peter, 1 Kepha chapter 2, verse 6 through 9. Got it? You sure? Positive? You awake now? Good. That's very good. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 6 through 9. This is why the Tanakh says, look, I am laying in Zion a stone, a chosen and precious cornerstone. And whoever rests his trust on it will certainly not be humiliated. Now to you who keep trusting, he is precious. But to those who are not trusting, the very stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. Also, he is a stone that will make people stumble, a rock over which they will trip. They are stumbling at the word, disobeying it, as had been planned. But you, a chosen people, the king's Kohanim, a holy nation, a people for Elohim to possess. Why? In order for you to declare the praises of the one who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Amen? Okay, so we go back to that, what Kepha is talking about. Look, he's laying in Zion, a chosen, precious cornerstone. Whoever rests his trust on it will certainly not be humiliated. Okay? It's very important to get this concept before you move on. Okay? Yaakov rests his head. It's dark. He's alone. He's got to learn how to trust the Lord. He's going to take a while. He's going to have to pay for his mistake. Okay? But the Lord is going to, what we're going to go back to in a moment, the Lord is going to show him a promise. He's going to be with him because he's resting his head on the rock. See, a lot of times people pull us away from resting our trust in the rock. We're more interested in pleasing man than we are in pleasing God. And that's one of the key issues of why men and women fall. Is because they want to please people instead of pleasing Hashemayim, heaven. Okay? So it's got to be a relationship between you and Yehovah. Rest your head on the rock that you can trust. Amen? So now let's go back to Bereshit 28. Bereshit, Genesis 28, verse 12. Genesis, Bereshit 28, verse 12. He dreamt that there was before him a ladder resting on the ground with its top reaching to heaven, and the angels of Jehovah were going up and down on it. Amen? Now, a ladder represents a tool. Okay? So in Yaakov's dream, there is a ladder. Okay? It's a vision. It's not really a dream. Okay? It says a dream, but when you go deeper, it's a vision. The Lord is showing him work that he's going to have to do. Okay? The ladder, he sees angels going up and down the ladder. Okay? What does a ladder represent? The ladder is between earth, Eretz, and Hashemayim. What does a ladder represent? A ladder represents a thing that you must climb. It's not like an escalator that takes you up. A ladder is something that you are now going to have to do the work. A ladder is a step by step. You don't generally take two steps on a ladder. Some people do, but most people, I've watched firemen do it, they're very careful, especially the higher you go. You know, you want to make sure your foot is really firm on that ladder. The ladder is a tool that is going to reach heaven. The ladder is a dream given by Jehovah, the chosen servant of Yaakov. The ladder goes between the ground, and Yaakov is sleeping. He's got his head on the rock. So now it's a ladder. The ladder, the main purpose of the ladder is the angels are going up and down. Okay? Those close to God who can see his glory are going up and down. Now the ladder is going to be for Yaakov because he's the chosen one. He's a child of the promise, a son of the promise. Okay? So he's going up and down. The ladder is one step at a time. Okay? One step at a time. Now the ladder is dangerous. Okay? The higher you go, you can slip. You know, your foot falls and you get trapped and you're hanging from the ladder. If there's moisture, it can be very treacherous. So the ladder is going to say that you can reach heaven. Let me say that again. Because in the vision, the dream, the ladder is resting on the ground, but it's reaching heaven. So there's going to be a process that he's showing Yaakov. Now that you've left your family, okay, now you're going to have to work extremely hard to get to heaven. It is obtainable. Let me say that again. You're going to work hard. You're going to have to work hard because the higher you get, you know, this week in the Parash, I asked the children, I'm like, how many of you are afraid of heights? And like pretty much all of them, okay? I'm afraid of widths, okay? I'm not afraid of heights. But anyway, the higher you go, like imagine this ladder going from earth to heaven, that's pretty, how high do you think heaven is? Like 10 miles, 5 miles, I don't know, so I asked the kids and, they don't know mileage. So I'm like, so imagine going up, the higher you go, now you're like 2 miles in the air and you're like, imagine, the wind is blowing. Remember Kepha was where, he was walking on the water, and as long as he kept his eye on Yeshua, okay, as long as he kept his eye on Yeshua, he was able to reach his destination, okay? So here, the higher you get, you will get to heaven. The higher you get, as long as you stay with the Lord, as long as you keep progressing nice and slowly towards the goal of Hashemayim, you're going to reach your destination. Okay, now that's the other key about the ladder, is that you have to do the work. The angels are coming up and down to assist you. The angels are coming up and down to protect you. The angels are coming up and down to maybe bring gifts to you. They're coming. It says there, look, read verse 12. He dreamt that there was before him was a ladder resting on the ground with its top reaching to heaven, and the angels of Jehovah were going up and down on it. Okay, the angels of Jehovah were going up and down on it. Okay, so here, now, he's stepping through it, back and forth, where you're going up and down. Now let's hold our place there, because the ladder is a narrow gate, and so is the gate that leads into heaven. So now, let's take that gifts that they're possibly bringing, those angels are going up and down, okay? Hold your place there. Turn to John 1, Gospel of Yochanan. John chapter 1, verse 48 through 51. John chapter 1, Yochanan 1, verse 48 through 51. John chapter 1. Verse 48 to 51. Nathanael said to him, "How do you know me?" Yeshua answered him, "Before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you." Nathanael said, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Yeshua answered him, "You believe all this just because I told you I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than that." Then he said to him, "Yes, indeed, I tell you that you will see heaven opened and the angels of God going up and coming down on the Son of Man." Amen? He's referencing, as long as you climb the ladder, as long as you follow the procedures, as long as you follow the narrow path, as long as you follow God's laws, then each step brings you closer to Hashemayim. But if you don't, you're just going to be stuck on the ground, and you're going to, the wind is going to blow, and it's going to beat your house down into nothing. So he says in Nathanael, which means the gift of God, saying, you're going to see the angels of God going up and coming down on the Son of Man. Just like the ladder, okay? So Jacob's ladder, okay? Yaakov's ladder, as long as you do the work, you will reach your destination. But if you don't, you're going to slip, you're going to fall, you're going to crash, you're going to burn. All right? Let's move on to the next part. Go back to Bereshit 28. Bereshit 28, verse 13. It's a really cool picture. Extraordinary picture. Must have been loud as the Dickens. And then the picture there you see, and if you're listening to this or you don't see it, you can click on the HQ version of the Parash, and you can see the pictures because we're putting them up as we're recording. We're trying to do as much production as possible with these teachings to give people the picture of what's going on. Okay, and if you don't see it, you can download the PowerPoint also. They're free. Okay, and if you want, you know what, hit the daggone donate button. Okay, Genesis 28, verse 13. Then suddenly Jehovah was standing there next to him, and he said, "I am Jehovah, your Elohim of Abraham, your father, and the Elohim of Yitzhak. The land on which you are lying, I will give to you and your descendants." Amen. This is a very important line, because God never breaks promises. You know, what was going on last week before we got rid of, well, praise God, today we got a new president. Hopefully he's going to be a lot different than his predecessor, who absolutely hated Israel. Okay, but the land that Yaakov was laying on, okay, that's part of Israel's land. And people are just trying to give it away. The world is trying to give it away. It is not theirs to give away. It has been given to, from God to us. Now, here, it's very interesting in verse 13. Let's read it again. We're now going to focus on the Lord suddenly standing there. Then suddenly, Jehovah was standing there next to him. And he said, I am Jehovah, the Elohim of Abraham, your grandfather, and the Elohim of Yitzhak. The land on which you are lying, I will give to you and your descendants. Amen? So here, it does say, in the CJB, it says Adonai, but it is not, in the Hebrew, it says Jehovah, means the existing one, tells Yaakov that he still keeps promises. Now, that's a very interesting understanding. Because remember, as we've been talking about in the two parashas, last week we did number 6, okay? And Yaakov made some pretty big mistakes. But Jehovah says, I'm going to be with you. We're going to work out your errors. And that, now, that's a great blessing. Jehovah suddenly is standing there, okay? Why are we focusing on this? Because all of us make errors. Some make bigger errors than not, okay? Some make small errors, some make big errors, but we have the God that does forgive, okay? You're going to have to do some work because of your disgusting errors, but the Lord says, I'm going to keep my promise with you, okay? I'm going to keep my promise, okay? And this is Jehovah, and it's not Yeshua that's standing there. It's not the Ruach HaKodesh. It says suddenly Jehovah, the existing one. That's the Father. The Father came down and said, I made a promise to your grandfather and to your father. Now I'm going to keep the promise to you, but you're going to have to do the work of climbing that ladder. When Daddy, I'm going to have to come down there. If I got to come down there, there's going to be a problem. Okay? He said, I'm going to keep my promise, but because you made a mistake, a big mistake, I'm going to come down and tell you personally what's going to happen. Okay? He tells the land that you're going to be, you're sleeping on is going to be yours forever. The promise is very important. It's a specific promise because the Ishmaelim and the Esavim say that it's their land. This is why Jehovah comes down himself and says, I'm going to give it to you and your descendants. Not Esau, not Ishmael, but to Yaakov. Abraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov. Okay? This is a promise that the Lord himself is telling that he's going to keep the promise. Okay? So it's very important to memorize this verse because the liars out there, the Muslims, the Arabs, they don't know how to tell the truth. They'll say, well, you know, Esau, you know, Yaakov stole the birthright. All right, let's just say that's true. It's not, but let's just say it is. The Lord, Jehovah, the Father, knows all things. And he came down himself to say, listen, I'm going to keep my promise with you. To your father, and your grandfather, I made a promise. You're the one that they blessed. Okay? You're the one who keeps the promise. It's very important to keep that in mind because the land that Israel's on is not just that little piece. It's a lot bigger. Okay? So the Lord said, even after your blunder, I'm going to keep the promise. Now, this is also a good understanding for those who have the replacement theology type of people, okay? That the blessings have been given over to the pagan Sunday ham-eating, Christmas tree-loving church. No, God doesn't break promises. Jehovah never breaks a promise. He's not like people who break promises, okay? He keeps promises, and he constantly reminds us of that he does, all right? And let's, okay? Now, let's go on to 28, verse 17. It's a nice picture of a gate with a beautiful sunrise coming through it, and the birds in the distance there, and the cross at the top. And you know, it's a very Gothic-looking scene. It's a very beautiful picture that I chose for that one. The colors are really extraordinary. You know, it's one of the things, you know, I love about the Lord, how he paints pictures. I mean, just look at that sunlight coming through that and the streams of light. It's just amazing. You know, if you ever get a chance, do it like once every now and then, once every like week or so. Get up early in the morning and see the sunrise. See the sunrise. Okay? And then at night, you know, if you live by, especially if you live by water in a warm area, see the sun hit the water and you can hear it go, shh, goes out. No. All right, 28 verse 17. Then he became afraid and said, "This place is fearsome. This has to be the house of Elohim. This is the gate of heaven." Amen. Yaakov was like, "Wow, oh my goodness. Oh, the goodness, I am not knowing what to be doing." All right, so he said, he became afraid, and the place is fearsome. This is the house Beit Elohim. Okay, this is the gate of Hashemayim. Now, what's so important about calling it a gate? Now think back what we've learned so far tonight. Okay, he shows him a ladder. Angels going up and down. Okay, a ladder is going to do work. You don't just slide down a ladder. It's not chutes and ladder to get the little kitty game. Whee, chutes and ladder. No, if you fall down a ladder, it's going to hurt. So you got to be careful. Then Yehovah himself comes down and says, "I'm going to keep the promise." Then Yaakov says, "Whoa, this is a fearsome place." Now, he says it's the gate of heaven. The ladder that you got to climb to reach the gate of heaven is work that you're going to have to do. The ladder is narrow. The gate is narrow. That's why Yeshua said the gate is narrow. Okay? Now, what is on the gate? What is on the gate of heaven? Hold your place there. Turn to Devarim 11, Deuteronomy 11, verse 20. Devarim 11, how are you going to get into heaven? What type of work you got to do? What's going to be on the gate of heaven? If Jehovah is the same yesterday, today, and forever, what's going to be on the gate of heaven? Devarim 11, Deuteronomy 11, verse 20. Devarim 11, verse 20. "And write them on the door frames of your house and on your gates." Amen? This is the mezuzah, the laws of God that we're going to put on our gates, on our doors. If you don't have land, if you live in an apartment like myself, you know, you put your mezuzah on your door. That's your gate, the gate to your apartment. You know, you lock your doors because you don't want to let anybody into your house and stuff like that. But on those gates, on those doors, the Lord said to write these laws on the gate. So here, why is Yaakov saying this is the gate of heaven? Because he's going to need to do some work. He's going to need to climb that ladder. He's going to need to follow that narrow path because you know you go wide on the ladder, you're going to go, "Wow!" Okay, you're going to fall off the ladder. You say you're 2 miles in the air. Well, woo! Okay, so here, getting into heaven, there's on the gate of heaven, this is for sure, because God does not change. Remember when the new Hashemayim comes down, the new Jerusalem comes down, there's 12 gates. There's not the British gate, the Polish gate, the Syrian gate, the 12 tribes of Israel. And what's going to be on each gate? What's going to be on each gate? The mezuzah, the laws of God. So if you're not following them now, you're not going to follow them then. You're not going to be led into dad's house. Okay? So here, be afraid. You should be afraid because you should fear God. You should want to know more about what is your responsibility. What is your responsibility? This house to be the house of God. Yes, the house of God. You got to climb that ladder to get to the house of God. You got to do work. Yourself, each person has to do the work. The angels are going up and down. The ladder's not wide. The gate is small. Okay? So here, You got to do the work to get into the part where you're going to reach the gate. And, you know, St. Peter is not at the gate. I know what the Catholics say. Well, St. Peter's at the gate. No. Yeshua's at the gate because he's the gatekeeper. He's the gatekeeper. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, the gatekeeper. Okay? Now turn to Deuteronomy 16, Devarim 16. Devarim 16, verse 18. You're to appoint judges and officers for all your gates. Yehovah your Elohim is giving you tribe by tribe, and they are to judge the people with righteous judgment. Amen? They're going to judge people with righteous... Where are they judging? And why are they judging in that place? Where are they judging? They're judging at the gate. What is on the gate? The mezuzahs on the gate. What did Yaakov say? This is the gate of heaven. Okay? He had made mistakes. Yehovah made a promise to him. You're going to have to do some work. Okay? Appointing judges. The judges need to be schooled in the laws of God. Because you don't want them just doing whatever they want. You want a standard of laws that don't change. Let me say that again. Appoint judges and officers that are trained in the same law, the same way of thinking. So when they hear cases in each of the cities, they will have a standard of judgment that does not change. Okay? And they're going to be doing the judgment in the sight of the mezuzah, the sight of God's laws. And why does God want them doing that? To remind them that this is what your standard of judgment is. Don't go to the right, you'll run into the wall. Don't go to the left, you're going to run into the wall. Okay? What you want to do is have a way of living going through that step-by-step process on the narrow ladder so you don't fall off, having a good grip on each step. This is why we're doing the Parash on Erev Shabbat. I want you to have a good grip on the main understandings. You know, there's a lot of people that focus on lineage and who's who and whatever. It doesn't matter to me. Prophecy doesn't matter. What matters to me in this ministry is teaching what's going to get you into heaven. I don't care about prophecy. It's going to happen. No matter what I do, it's going to happen. What matters is that if you were to die today, would you be on that ladder? Would you be able to climb the ladder? Would you be knocked off the ladder? If you got to the gate, would they say, who are you? Is your name in this book? You're going to be judged on the books, it says in Revelation. The books are Torah. So what are you? So here, you're to appoint judges that know the law. They're at the gate. They're going to judge you according to the standard of God's law. Okay? Now, let's now keep holding our place in Genesis, but turn to the Gospel of Yochanan, John chapter 10. John chapter 10, verse 1, 2, 3. We're going to keep focusing on the gate for a little bit, okay? To get a full understanding of how important that gate of heaven is. John chapter 10, verse 1, 2, 3. Gospel of John, Yochanan 10, verse 1, 2, 3. Yes, indeed, I tell you, the person who doesn't enter the sheep's pen through the door, but climbs in some other way, is a thief and a robber. But the one who goes in through the gate is the sheep's own shepherd. This is the one the gatekeeper admits. The sheep hear his voice. He calls his own, each one by name, and leads them out. Amen? Okay, so here Yeshua is the gatekeeper. He calls each one by name. He's going to call you by name if you're his. And how are you going to be his? If you're part of his sheep penfold. Okay? But if you want to try to climb into heaven some other way, some Catholic way, some Protestant way, some Methodist way, some Baptist way, you're doing Sunday worship, It isn't likely that you're going to get into heaven. It is not likely. Okay? So Yeshua is saying here, if you enter in through the door that I'm telling you, what's on the door? Why does he use the reference, he's a Jew, talking to other Jews? Okay? What would be on the door of every Jewish person's home? The mezuzah, the laws of God. That is our gate, the gate into our home, the gate that leaves our home. Okay? So we look at verse 2 again, but the one who goes in through the gate is the sheep's own shepherd. Okay? So here, talking about the gate, this goes back to Bereshit, where Yaakov said, this is a fearsome, this must be the gate of heaven. Yeshua is the gate of heaven. He's the shepherd at the gate's door. Okay? If you try to get in, bah, bah, get out of here. You're not my sheep. And you try to get in, but I want to get in there. I want to go in there now. I realize it's real. You know, I realize your Bible is real and I didn't follow it. But no, it's too late now. It's too late now. Now let's take a little bit more. Turn to Matthew 7. Matthew 7. Let's look a little bit more at the gate. Matthew 7, verse 13 and 14. Matthew 7, verse 13 and 14. We're looking more at the gate. Matthew 7, Matthew 7, verse 13 and 14. Going through the narrow gate, for the gate that leads to destruction is wide and the road broad. And many travel it, but it is a narrow gate and a hard road that leads to life, and only a few find it. Amen? Man, Yeshua, I thought all I had to do was say I got it covered in the blood of Jesus. Well, evidently not. Okay, going through the narrow gate. And when Yeshua said it's a hard road, climbing that ladder, you know, after a little while, you know, your feet get a little tired. You know, you're on that rung, you know, and your feet start getting tired. Your calves, when you're climbing up a high ladder, man, your calves start to, you know, and your hands are like you're holding yourself. And then it's a ladder that's a little older. Sometimes it sways a little bit. I used to climb like 40-foot ladders, you know, when I worked in the theater. You know, you had to go switch the lights and stuff like that. And people are like, that ladder's shaking. Okay. So here, it's a hard road. That ladder, Yeshua's saying it's hard. It's not impossible. It's hard to get to that gate. Okay. This hard road, it leads to life. When you follow the commandments of God, see, Yaakov had made a very large mistake. He went along with a lie. He made a very large mistake. And when somebody wants to take you down a road of a lie, forget it. Say, I'm sorry. I'm not going to be part of it. You can go do what you want. You may not like me. You may not call me again. Whatever. I'd rather serve my God than serve man. Now, finally, let's turn to Revelation 22, verse 14 and 15. Revelation 22, verse 14 and 15. We're focusing on the gate and the work that is required. Revelation 22, verse 14 and 15. How blessed are those who wash their robes so that they have the right to eat from the tree of life and go through the gates into the city. Outside are the homosexuals, those involved with the occult and with drugs, the sexually immoral, murderers, idol worshippers, and everyone who loves and practices falsehood. Amen? They have the right to eat. They get eat from the tree of life and go through what? Go through what? The gate of the city. The gate of the city. What's going to be on the gate of that city that Yeshua is telling Yochanan? Yeshua's angel is telling Yochanan in this understanding of the end of days. What's going to be on that gate? It's going to be a mezuzah on the gate. And why is it? Because there's redemption for those who make mistakes and put your head on the rock. You rest your head on the rock in the dark places. You're in the desert alone. You got to rest your head on the rock because the wind is going to blow. The storm is going to come. You're not going to be beaten down now because you're resting on the firm foundation. You're going to climb that ladder. You're going to go in through that narrow port that the ladder is going to lead to, because when you climb that ladder, like a fireman's climbing that ladder, he's going to then climb in through that entrance and that gate. What's going to be on the gate that Yeshua is talking about here In Revelation 22:14, the gate of the city is going to have a mezuzah. Quite fascinating, don't you think? All right, let's go back now to the next part of the Parash. Let's go to 29, verse 2 and 3. Genesis 29, Bereshit 29, verse 2 and 3. Bereshit 29, verse 2 and 3. Bereshit 29, Genesis 29, verse 2 and 3. As he looked, he saw a well in a field, and there were three flocks of sheep lying there next to it, because they watered the sheep from that well. The stone on the well mouth was large. You know, only when all the flocks had gathered, they were there, would they roll the stone away from the opening of the well and water the sheep. Then they would put the stone back in its place of the well's opening. Amen. How many flocks were there? And they're waiting. There were three flocks. Now they're waiting for the fourth. Okay? They're waiting for the fourth. Okay? It's very interesting. Okay? Waiting for the fourth flock. Why the fourth? What's so important about the fourth? Okay? Well, what did the Lord make on the fourth day? The sun, the moon, and what else? The stars, the lights of heaven. Sun, the moon, the stars. Okay? We're waiting, but there's something else about that fourth seed. Once that fourth seed comes, that's when the living water gets given to the flocks. Fourth seed. What's important about the fourth flock? Hold your place there. Turn to Luke 8. Luke 8. Luke 8, verse 5 through 8. Luke 8, the Gospel of Luke, verse 5 through 8. Luke 8, verse 5 through 8. The farmer went out to sow his seed. As he sowed, some fell along the path and was stepped on, and the birds flying around ate it up. Some fell on the rock, and after it sprouted, it dried up from the lack of moisture. Some fell on in the midst of the thorns, and the thorns grew up with it and choked it. But some fell on rich soil and grew and produced 100 times as much as had been sown. After saying this, he called out, "Whoever has ears, let them hear." Amen. The fourth flock is the flock that needs to come, because that's going to produce the opening of the well. Four seeds. Road, rock, tangled in the world, finally the fourth falls on good ground and produces 100-fold. Once the next flock comes, they had three flocks there, but they're waiting for one more. They're waiting for one more. Once the fourth one comes, that's when the living water is poured out on all the sheep. In the fourth seed, it produces 100 times as much as had been sown. Okay? So then it produces enough so that everybody can eat. The fourth seed produces enough so everybody can eat. Because let's say you planted 10 seeds, and each one is producing 100-fold. You had 10 seeds, and each is producing 100-fold. How many would you have? You had 10 seeds, and each is producing 100-fold. 10 seeds. Doink, doink! Doink, doink! Michaela, help her out. Doink, doink. Huh? Doink, doink. Doink, doink. 100-fold. 10 times. All right, let's go to the next one. 10,000. A hundredfold, doink, doink. Doink, doink. Hundred, doink, doink. Genesis 29 now. Doink, doink. Verse 8. 10,000. 100 times 10. Doink, doink. Add two zeros. Genesis 29, verse 8. They answered, "We can't, not until all the flocks have been gathered together." And they rolled the stone away from the opening of the well. That's when we water the sheep. Amen? This also is a parable for later on. Once everything is said and done. Remember in the book of Revelation, it talks about once the number of those, once we, the Lord reaches the number that he knows that nobody else knows, then the end will come. Okay? So once the flocks are gathered, so here there's four flocks, okay, the four flocks, because they're waiting for Raquel. There's already three there. They're waiting for that fourth seed to arrive so that the son of the promise can open the well and the living water can come and feed the sheep. Now, why we're waiting for the water to be open, hold your place there in Genesis 29. Go to John 10 again. John 10, we're going to look at verse 16. John 10. 10 times 100-fold. John 10, verse 16. Doink, doink. John 10, verse 16. Also, I have other sheep which are not from this pen. I need to bring them, and they will hear my voice, and there will be one flock, one shepherd. Amen? So here we're waiting for the last flock to come in. Once that last flock comes in, they're one group of sheep. One group of sheep. They're all going to be watered now because the living water is going to come out. Yeshua is a shepherd. He's the son of the promise. He's going to bring out the living water, and there'll be one flock, one shepherd. All right, going on now to the next part of the Parash. Go back to Bereshit 29, verse 10. This is a beautiful picture. Okay? I don't know if he looked, he was that muscular. Remember, he was the guy that stayed in tents. 29:10. Bereshit 29:10. When Yaakov saw Rachel, the daughter of Laban, his mother's brother, and the sheep of Laban, his mother's brother, Yaakov went up and rolled the stone away from the opening of the well and watered the flock of Laban, his mother's brother. Amen? So here, the daughter of the family, the daughter who's going to be part of the family, the son of the promise comes. She brings her flock, and the son of the promise, the son of the promise, remember Jehovah appeared to him, the son of the promise comes and he rolls the stone away so that the living water can be poured out for all the flocks. Okay, the son of the promise rolls the stone away so that all the flocks can have the living water. Why is that so important? About the living water? Hold your place there. Turn to John 4. John 4. Yochanan 4, the Gospel of Yochanan, chapter 4, verse 9 through 12. 10 seeds, 100-fold. John 4, verse 9 through 12. Now you have to tell me something. Doink, doink. John 4, verse 9 through 12. The woman from Shamron said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask for water from me?" A woman from Shamron. Yeshua answered her, "If you knew God's gift, that is, who it is saying to you, 'Give me a drink of water,' then you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water. She said to him, Sir, you don't have a bucket, and the well is deep. So where do you get this living water? You aren't greater than our father Jacob, are you? He gave us this well and drank from it, and so did his sons and cattle. Amen? Greater than her father who? Yaakov. Yaakov is the one who rolled the stone away there. Okay? So here, this woman who was not part of the covenant, they had left they went with the northern tribes. Shamron was part of the northern kingdom. They had 19 bad kings, got taken away in Babylon, did a lot of pagan stuff. So now Yeshua, the living water, the one who is the living water, is talking to this woman saying, I have the living water. I'm going to give it to you if you accept me as Messiah. So he goes out and he gathers the flocks. The son of the promise is gathering the flocks. Let me say that again. Maybe you missed. The son of the promise is gathering the flocks. Amen. Now, one last part about this. Turn to Revelation 7, verse 17. Revelation 7, verse 17. Revelation, verse 7, verse 17. 10 seeds times 100. Each one. Yes. No, it's 10. Anyway, Revelation 7, verse 17. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will shepherd them, will lead them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Amen? Now, people always ask me, will we be crying in heaven? Yeah, but the Lord's going to wipe away your tears. Okay, I don't know how he's going to do that, whether he's going to give you a Kleenex or tissue or he's going to wipe them away with his hand or just go, whoosh. I don't know, but it says he's going to wipe them away. Now, the shepherd will lead them to springs of living water. The son of the promise will give you the living water. Son of the promise will give you living water. All right, that's done for that part there. Let's go to back to Genesis 29:17. And 18. 29, Bereshit 29, verse 17. Each seed. 29:17 and 18. It's always something. Leah's eyes were weak, but Rachel was good looking and with beautiful features. Yaakov had fallen in love with Rachel and said, I'll work for you for 7 years in exchange for Rachel, your younger daughter. Okay, amen? Now, here is two very important keys here. He mentioned 7 years. Okay, the seven is the year of the Shemitah. It's the year of release. So I'll work for this girl for 7 years. Okay, but he specifically says, okay, and this is also something of the Ishmaelim and those that are descendants of Esau, they don't know how to tell the truth. Because Yaakov said, I will work for 7 years for your younger daughter. Levon didn't say, we don't do that thing here. We got to give away the old one. So give me 14 years and I'll give you both two for the price of one. Okay? He didn't say that. Now, it's very specific because he does have to pay because of something he does later on. We'll talk about in a moment. But seven is an important number. Why is that? Hold your place there. Turn to Devarim 15. We're going to read about why he used seven. Devarim, Deuteronomy 15, verse 12 through 14. Actually, go to verse 1 first. Devarim 15, verse 1. Might be on the next slide. At the end of every 7 years, you are to have a Shemitah. Amen. After every 7 years, it's a remission of debt, a Shemitah, or Shemitah, whatever way you want to say. I like to say Shemitah, okay? Shemitah, Okay? After 7 years, the debt is paid off. You're released. So here Yaakov said, I'll work 7 years for your daughter Rachel. Okay? You know, he had fallen in love with Rachel when he saw her. Okay? He didn't fall in love with her mind. Okay? You know, he saw her and just, she's all that in a bag of chips, and at least to him it was. Okay? So here, you know, he didn't fall in love with her. Well, she's so intelligent, and she carries such great conversations. Okay? Leah's nice, you know, to talk with, but you know, she's got those weak eyes. Okay? So here he talks, and he says, the 7 years, this is what's so important about the seven and understanding why he said it. Okay, Torah is living in our heart. Now go to verse 12 through 14, please. 12 through 14. If your kinsman, a Hebrew man or woman, is sold to you, he's to serve you 6 years. But in the seventh year, you're to set him free. Moreover, when you set him free, don't let him leave empty-handed, but supply him generously from your flock, threshing floor, wine press, from what Yehovah your Elohim has blessed you with, you are to give him. Amen? So this is why also he finally does leave with a lot of flocks and herds, because he was working for free. He was a slave, basically, for the 7 years. Okay? So when, you know, a Hebrew man or woman, this is family, you let them work for 7 years. Okay, they are your slave, and there are rules about slavery that God said, but you can only keep a slave 7 years. This is one of the things that America did really wrong, saying they were Christian and having slaves and keeping them beyond the 7 years. Especially when many of the African people did accept Messiah Yeshua as their Lord and Savior. So then they are your brothers. So you work the 7 years, and then if they want to stay, you do the whole ear piercing to the door, and they have an earring, and that means they're your slave for forever. They can't leave. Okay? So here, the 7 years has to do with the Shemitah. Even before Torah was written, we're still following God's rules. Amen? Now let's move back to Genesis 29, and let's see another mistake Yaakov makes. Genesis 29, verse 21 and 22. Genesis 29, verse 21 and 22. Yaakov said to Laban, give me my wife, since my time is finished, so that I can start living with her. Laban gathered all the men at the place and gave a banquet. Amen? Now, he's worked 7 years. We're going to send him off. You know, going to give him a banquet. But remember, we read that Yaakov said, I'll work 7 years for the younger daughter, and you agreed to it. You agreed to it. Okay? Now, in the word feast or banquet there, okay, feast in some translations, but mishteh in the Hebrew means feast, drink, banquet. So you've heard me said in the past, well, he got drunk. Well, once you understand what the word feast means, it's a feast, there's going to be food, but there's going to be drink. Remember, at Purim, King Ahasuerus had a wine banquet. Everybody was supposed to drink. You could drink as much as you want. It wasn't a law, okay? But here, this is why, you know, 7 years, and what happens to Yaakov? In the morning, he wakes up and he's like, hey, well, Leah, what are you doing here? Well, you were drinking a little too much, and, you know, worked 7 years, and you fell in love with Rachel. You didn't fall in love with her mind. You fell in love with her eyes, okay? Her eyes, and you know, she was 22, okay? So, and you know, and there he is, he's at the banquet, and he's like, mucha cerveza. I only had 70, how many of those little cups did you have? 72, okay? You know, yeah, you're drinking a little wine at a time, but that adds up, and then you try to stand up, and you're like, woo, my head is going, wee. Okay, so here, misteh, is a feast, a drink, banquet. Okay? Now, what is so important about understanding that? Turn to John chapter 2, please. John chapter 2. A few more minutes, everybody. John chapter 2, verse 1, 2, 3. Yochanan 2, verse 1, 2, 3. Hopefully, you're learning something from this parash. And if you missed other parashas, like I said, we've designed a whole part on our website. It's not fully done, but there's a couple of years' worth of studies where you can, all in numerical order. When you see a blank spot, that means we didn't record or there was a holy day or something like that. Okay? John 2, verse 1, 2, 3. John 2, Yochanan 2. On Tuesday, There was a wedding at Cana in the Galilee. And the mother of Yeshua was there. Yeshua, too, was invited to the wedding along with the Talmudim. The wine ran out, and Yeshua's mother said to him, "They have no more wine." Amen? Now, this is another important thing, that they ran out of wine, okay? Now, here, before Yaakov could get Rachel, he had to finish out the marriage week with Leah. This type of behavior, this custom, was still followed through in the time of Yeshua. They ran out of wine because the wine had to last a week. Okay? They served the good wine at the beginning when the major guests are coming, but since everybody had to travel, they had a banquet for a week when somebody got married. And this is why they ran out of wine. Okay? And we know that from Genesis 29 with Rachel and Leah. Now go back to Genesis 29. Verse 23 to 25, Bereshit 29, verse 23 to 25. In the evening, he took Leah, his daughter, and brought her to Yaakov, and he went in and slept with her. Laban also gave his slave girl Zilpah, the daughter of Leah, the slave girl. In the morning, Yaakov saw that he was with Leah, and he said to Laban, "What kind of thing is that you've done to me? Didn't I work for Rachel? Why have you deceived me?" Okay? They deceived him, but once again, remember Noach. We wouldn't have some problems in the world had you not gotten drunk. Same goes here. You got to keep your mind about you as followers of Jehovah. You have to keep your mind about you all the time. Because when you let the spirit of the wine or the alcohol get into you, then bad things occur. Okay? Bad things occur. And here, you know, had he been sober for the first day of his married life, why would you know people of the world want to get drunk? You know, "I'm going to get married. I'm going to get drunk." Okay, getting drunk. Okay, don't get drunk. You know, be sober for your marriage. Okay, be very sober. Deceitfulness, the darkness. Okay, let's go now to the next part, verse 27 and 28. Finish the marriage week of this one, and we'll give you another one, also in exchange for work you will do for me during yet another 7 years. Yaakov agreed to this, so he finished her week, and Laban gave him the daughter Rachel as his wife. Amen? So you'd only have one wife if you were to just stay sober. Now you got two, and you got two households to take care of. Okay, you're going to have fighting between the two sisters, but what key here is the marriage week. Verse 27 is a very important understanding. God doesn't say to put this marriage week away. We call it now a honeymoon. Okay? We have one day of the marriage and 6 days away from people. Okay? So the couple can get to know one another and things like that. And that's what we call our honeymoon. Okay? But biblically, it is a marriage week. And the couple, you know, in the family is there. People are coming. But you're serving them food. You're doing all this stuff. It's a marriage week. A marriage week. So that way you understand John chapter 2, verse 3. The wine ran out because all the guests were coming to whatever wedding that was that Yeshua was invited to. And it was a marriage week. It was the end of the week. So the Sabbath was coming and they ran out of wine. And that's why Yeshua turned the water into wine. All right? Now we move on. Moving on. Genesis 29, verse 32 is our last part that we're going to take a look at here. Genesis 29, verse 32. Leah conceived and gave birth to a son, whom she called, whom she named Reuven. He said, for she said, "It is because Jehovah has seen how humiliated I have been, but now my husband will love me." Amen. So here, when a man has a son, he has a good thing. And Leah was saying, "I've given him a son. He will love me." And you have a daughter that does not do the math, and, you know, could be a kind of... Now, what is interesting, though, because in this chapter, we're not going to go over all the names. I like to go through all the names and when we get to the blessings of Genesis 49. But I did put a chart on because it is interesting to see who's who. Okay? You got in the chart there, Leah, Zilpah, Bilhah, and Rachel. Okay, Leah gives Yaakov 4 sons and 1 daughter. Okay, Reuven, Shimon, Levi, Yehuda, and Issachar and Zebulun also. Okay, then Dinah is also that. The one girl is also part of Leah, the first wife. Okay, Zilpah gives Gad and Asher. Okay, Bilhah, and where these women come from, nobody knows. I've looked it up. I've even studied Talmud. Like, where does Zilpah and Bilhah come from? Nobody knows. Okay, nobody has a consensus on this. And then Rachel gives Benjamin and Yosef. Okay, and then you see in the chart who you got. Yehuda is a 4th son, which is in the line of King David, which is in Yeshua's line. Levi is Moshe and Aaron. Okay, the Levite, the priest, the high priest. Aaron, Zadok, and the high priest. So the chart is very good because sometimes it's good to know who's whose mother, who's the slave girl. The children have, you know, all equal rights. Okay, all the children have equal rights in birth order unless they blow it, you know, by doing something bad. Okay, but here the you have 2 wives and 2 concubines. Okay, the concubines do not have the same rights in Torah as the wives do. Okay, and the first wife does have more rights than the second wife as per Torah. Okay, so here it is good to have the chart. All right, that's all the time we have for tonight. I bid you amen and a amen.
Shalom. This is Messianic Rabbi Andrew Dinnerman. I would personally like to thank you for tuning in to the Remnant's Call each and every week. You can listen to the full message on our website, bethgoyim.org. If you have drawn closer to the King of Kings, learned more about Him today, we are blessed. If you are blessed by these messages, please consider a donation to our ministry. You can go to our website, bethgoyim.org. That's bethgoyim.org. And click on the donate button. You do not have to have a PayPal account to donate. All you need is a debit card. Once again, thank you very much for listening to The Remnant's Call.
If you have not taken your first steps to be born again, just ask God's help. Remember, it's His loving grace that has come to find you. No one is worthy or able to reach God, but God can reach us, and He's reaching out to you now. Just open your heart and let Him in. His arms are open, and the blessing of salvation and eternal life are waiting for you. Don't let it wait any longer.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord lift His face and shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious unto you and give you His shalom.
Shalom. My name is Messianic Rabbi Andrew Dinnerman, and I invite you to come to visit our congregation. If you are in the tri-state area, come out and visit with us on Shabbat. We are a congregation of Jews and Gentiles living as one in the Messiah Yeshua. Bgmc is a place of true worship. The focus never wanders from the Hebraic roots of our faith. Beth Goyim is rooted in the Word of God from Bereshit through to the Book of Revelation. Messiah's strong words against man-made tradition are carefully recorded in Matthew 7. That is the reason we only follow the straight-up instructions found in Scripture. Truly, the way, the truth, and the life. If you're looking for a deeper walk with Adonai, come out for our Tuesday evening Bible study called Messianic Torah Time. Come, spend the day with us on any Shabbat. We start at 11 a.m. with the sound of the ancient Hebrew shofar. Next, we offer our King praise and worship in English, Hebrew, and Spanish. After worship, we review the headlines in the previous week's news from around the globe, especially news from the Holy Land Israel. We don't just list the news headlines as current events, but we comb through the scriptures, searching for clues to understand what they mean, and then to help pinpoint prophetically our current position on Adonai's clock. After digesting all that modern information, we leave the world behind as we journey with our Adonai deep into his eternal word, not with just one or two scriptures, but usually seven or more scriptures. The spiritual nourishment and the richness of his kingdom become accessible to the ones who share this special time and seek them out. The day does not end there. Because Shabbat is so special to him, there is always so much more that our King desires to share. So instead of separating and leaving, we stay together as a family for potluck lunch and an afternoon study of our King's Word. We close the Shabbat together with the reading of the new week's Parashah. That's the Torah portion. Even after those blessings, many of us just can't get enough. So the members bring prepared homemade foods to share while we all enjoy an uplifting movie together. If all that information is not quite enough, you can check out our website where you will find over 200 video teachings and biblical holy day studies. Under Messianic Torah Time, the Hebrew Roots button, you'll discover free studies on many, many different topics, including PowerPoint slide presentations. If Beth Goyim sounds like a place you'd love to visit, but you live outside the tri-state area, there is still a way to connect with us. We stream live on the internet on Tuesday, Thursday, and Shabbat. The website is www.bethgoyim.org. That's BETHGOYIM.org. Our phone number is 973-338-7800 or 978-2-YESHUA. That's 978, the number 2, Yeshua. Shalom.